Let's talk more about the science behind this and how it works. Joining me now is Lee Billings, senior space and physics editor at Scientific American. He'll be with us for all 2 hours of this special. And I'm serious. I am walking into space right now, into the VR that we've created. It's actually pretty cool, huh?
It is. It's fancy meeting here.
Even
in space.
For a scientist?
Yeah, I'm overwhelmed. All the stars.
You don't normally get to see this here in New York City. Don't walk off platform. You're going to fall into space and leave, and we'll never see you again.
Okay.
Why is this so special?
It's special for so many reasons, some of which you've laid out. So on average, a total eclipse only comes to any part of the surface around 360 years or so. It's also very special scientifically because we're going to be able to learn a lot more about the sun and how it affects space weather and things like that by studying its outer atmosphere, its corona, which you can see, that glowing diaphanous haze around the full eclipsed sun. The sun is now in an activity cycle at its peak. It has an 11-year cycle. And so we're now able to see it in, like, in 2017, our eclipse back then, when it was at the low of the cycle. It's now at the peak of the cycle. We'll be able to see better how the solar magnetic fields affect the corona and ultimately life here on Earth through space weather.
NASA's sending rockets up right now.
That's right. They got three sounding rockets they're sending up. There's also a chase plane that's going to be looking at the corona and the eclipse and getting as much of that totality as possible by chasing the moon's shadow across the country. And there's other reasons it's very special, too. You mentioned how this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, so special. You know, it's not going to be like this forever, though. If we were around 620 million years from now, actually, we wouldn't be getting any more total eclipses.
What do you mean?
Well, the moon is slowly moving away from the Earth about an inch and a half every year. That's due to tidal pull from the ocean, and it makes the moon's orbit speed up slightly, so it drifts out. And that means that in about 620 years, the best you'll get is that ring of fire annular eclipse. And so we won't be able to study the corona like we can now. We won't be able to see this special thing. It really is a cosmically...
So the moon will be smaller
in comparison
to the sun.
We won't have that 400 times smaller on the sun.
So we really are lucky. It is a blessing. It's a blessing and a fluke that we just happen to be able to see this on our planet with our moon and the sun where it is and in this moment in human history.
That's right. That's right. As far
or
as
Earth's
we know,
history, I should history. Say. Who knows how long human history is going to last.
Right. I mean, and that's the thing. The next eclipse is only going to be in, 2044 for the contiguous U.S., 2045 for the actual, get a sash-like strip across the entirety of the country. 2044 is just going to be in, South Dakota and Montana. And then Alaska is in 2038. But who wants to go to northern Alaska to see an eclipse?
I do.
I do, too. Actually.
Let's talk about what we're seeing right now in Mazatlan. We have that in the upper left-hand or right-hand box.
Yeah. So it looks right now like obviously totality has passed. Now the moon is moving past the sun and revealing more and more of the face. So the fireworks have kind of stopped. Earlier, if you were looking on this channel, you could have seen that close-up of Mazatlan, the totality, and you could see a little solar prominence, which is kind of like this thing I have in my shirt. Which I know I'm not on camera right now, but a little kind of prominence, little glowing red spot, and that's plasma that's being ejected from the sun. And so that's kind of what we're looking at when we're studying this scientifically. We're looking at the way that the sun's surface, its visible surface, affects this outer corona.
In this moment, it looks like the sun is the moon. It looks like a crescent moon.
It does.
We're waiting for a few different phenomena. There's the Bailey's beads, right?
Oh, yes,
and
yes.
The diamond ring effect. Has that already passed? Are we about to see it?
Unfortunately, the Bailey's beads have already happened. That's around totality. And what that is, that's a very good shout there, Kate.
Yeah, I did my research.
That's when you can maybe see a little bit of it right here, but not exactly. But you're looking, notice how it's not a perfect circle. It's not a perfect outline of the moon there, the silhouette. There's slight little changes, and some of that is topography. Some of that is actually mountains on the moon that we're seeing, and the sun shining through
it. So it's the sun going through the mountains.
That's right.
And that's why you're seeing a little bit more sun in areas than others, and it looks like beads.
Like beads, that's right.
Let's talk about the science behind this, because it's about every 18 months that there is a total eclipse somewhere on Earth.
That's right.
How come it takes so long for it to pass over one area? Why is it 360 years or potentially more for a total solar eclipse to happen in any specific area?
So that's mostly because of what's called the plane of the ecliptic. That's the plane...
We can show everyone, by the way, because we have this incredible studio. So talk to me about the sun and the moon.
I'm going to gesticulate. Okay, so if you see how all the sun and the moon and the Earth are all kind of in a line. Now, if some of those little dots in the background are planets, that's actually the plane of the ecliptic. The plane of the ecliptic is where all the planets tend to orbit, except Pluto, but that's another story. And the moon, however, does not orbit in the plane of the ecliptic, and that's just kind of a quirk, a cosmic accident that came about from when the moon was created, we believe, by a giant impact between a protoplanet and the moon, you know, more than 4.5 billion years ago. And so since it's not in the plane of the ecliptic, that means it's not going to always eclipse the sun. If it was in the ecliptic, then we'd have a solar eclipse every single time, every month, basically.
Every month, wow.
Somewhere on the planet. But yeah, you know, that basically, you look at the orbital geometry, things change around, right? I know I'm being really scientific here, but if you think about where the moon and the sun are versus respect to Earth, they change, so that's why it's not always in the same place at the same time.
So if it was every month, then you wouldn't have had the ancient civilizations thinking that the world was ending, or dragons were eating the sun,
right,
or there should be ritual sacrifice because the gods are angry.
It would just be normal. They'd be like, okay, yeah, you know, that happens every single month.
We're going to get into some of the history, because the history of eclipses and how humans have interpreted it is fascinating. A little scary, also fascinating.
Hey, everyone. MSNBC has a new and improved app. You'll get real-time alerts and analysis, live blogs, in-depth essays, video highlights, and the best 2024 election coverage. Download the new MSNBC app. Here's how to do it. You tap on the App Store on your phone. You hit search on the bottom right corner. You type in MSNBC. You click on the MSNBC app. You click on get or the cloud icon and enjoy it.